Naruto Shippuden Ultimate Ninja Storm 4 Road to Boruto is a fascinating release in terms of timing. It is predominantly the final chapter in a recap of an anime series that had not ended yet when the game released, leaving it in an incomprehensible position for anyone that isn't a Naruto fan. I happen to fall into that category, having stopped watching the original series as a kid sometime around episode 80, but having absorbed a lot of information about the direction the series went in from hanging around general anime fandoms. Playing Ultimate Ninja Storm 4 from that perspective is odd, since there are a lot of great over-the-top moments that even excited me, but there are just as many plain moments that exist just to cover events that took place in the Naruto manga that aren't comprehensive enough for newcomers to understand, and I assume are too dull for existing fans to really be interested in revisiting. The gameplay in Ultimate Ninja Storm 4 is your typical anime arena fighter. You can run around the circular playing field and need to punch your opponent until they fall down. Unique series elements like chakra attacks and ninja acrobatics are there too, but for the most part, combat pretty much boils down to just mashing the A button over and over and over again. It's not particularly interesting to play until you run into one of those over-the-top moments I mentioned. Big story beats from the manga and anime are featured in flashy cutscenes with quick-time events that the game calls interactive actions. If you pull off the quick-time events, you're rewarded with an extended cutscene at the end of the fight that ties everything together with a neat bow. The gameplay also occasionally gets shaken up with different mechanics, like a full-on shoot-'em-up boss battle in space or grinding down a rail with a giant toad like your Sonic the Hedgehog. My favorite moment in the entire game is a fight between Kakashi and Obito, two characters who have known each other since they were kids, where the match would seamlessly transition into a flashback to their youth, highlighting their history together. It's big, flashy set pieces like this that make Ultimate Ninja Storm 4 fun for even a newcomer like me. They are a blast to see on screen, but unfortunately the story mode fills more of its time with slow, stilted cutscenes. A shocking number of the cutscenes are just still frames lifted straight from the anime, and while some of them do feature the full 3D models and graphics of the game engine, they're often just as flat and uninteresting, never quite managing to capture the excitement of actually watching the anime. By the end of the story, I honestly started skipping a lot of the cutscenes, and I imagine a lot of people playing will do that as well. The story is totally unconcerned with explaining itself to newcomers, and I can't see any reason that fans of the series would really care to see the story they've already witnessed on screen play out in a less interesting way in a video game. Available to play after the story is the Adventure Mode, which recaps some events from the series that Ultimate Ninja Storm 4 didn't cover. This mode opens up into an open-world adventure map that you traverse between fights, but it doesn't really add a whole lot to the game. I saw one comment online refer to it as the shame hole they put the bad parts of the previous games in, and I can't help but agree. There isn't a lot worth seeing in the open world map, and the fights never get as flashy or over the top as the story mode does, so there's not much reason to check out the adventure mode unless you really want to spend more time with the characters. The Road to Boruto DLC included in the Switch version suffers from the same problems. It's pretty much just the adventure mode, with full voice acting and different characters. I'm sure that Ultimate Ninja Storm 4 is much more enticing to a fan of the series than it is to me, but there are still some big issues with the game that drag it down a lot. Sitting through long, low-budget cutscenes between fights was boring enough for me, so I can't see why someone who already knows the entire story would put up with them, even out of love for the characters and world. At the end of those cutscenes, though, there are some crazy good set pieces that fulfill the potential the rest of the game could have had. Fans of the series probably owe it to themselves to see those moments, if nothing else. Meanwhile, everyone else is probably better off staying away, since those exciting payoffs really aren't worth the slow buildup that it takes to get to them.
This video was made possible by our generous supporters on Patreon. Did you know that Nintendo World Report is funded directly by fans like you? When you support Nintendo World Report on Patreon, you get immediate access to multiple exclusive podcasts every month, exclusive Discord channels, an early look at select content, and more, all for as little as $1 a month. Check out patreon.com/NWR for all the details.